Good morning, and welcome to Morning Movie News. First of all, I am so happy that so many of you enjoyed Friday's episode of Morning Movie News, dedicated solely to viewer questions. And the response was so great. It was so much fun to go through the comments section and see all of your wonderful questions and just to basically hear your thoughts on what we're discussing here, that I've decided, due to that overwhelmingly wonderful response, to make it a regular occurrence. I think I'm going to start out doing it maybe twice a month, and Shezzy actually had a really good suggestion of putting it on the weekends, and that way I don't miss any news stories in the regular Morning Movie News episodes, but on the weekend I can really dive in there and answer like four, maybe even five of your questions because you guys have so many great ones. And also on that note, I just wanted to point out that even if I don't always respond, I don't want you guys to think that your questions are just going out there and not being seen. At least for the first 3 to 4 days of a video, especially on something like that which is so interactive, I do check the comments and read every single one. So I just don't want anyone to think that their time isn't being utilized well. I mean, I think I can see a lot of you put a lot of thought into your questions and you're legitimately interested in the answer. So I'm going to try to get to them. And there are just so many good ones, but they are being read. I am seeing them and I'm trying to respond to as many as possible. And potentially I'll try and answer some that I don't think I'm going to be able to get to in a video. I'll try and do that going forward. But it was so much fun. It was really great. Your energy and your response was fantastic. So I'm glad that there will be a new segment here that we all can enjoy with these viewer dedicated Morning Movie News episodes starting in January. All right, so on to today's news stories for today's episode of Morning Movie News. Hollywood's very quiet over the holidays in terms of official headlines, but there are some whispers going around that are fascinating. Now, a number of you have pointed out to me a rumor that Denzel Washington is up for the role of Lex Luthor. And it looks like that rumor came from a very interesting place, and that he is apparently talking to the DC Warner Brothers offices about the movies, but it might be for John Stewart. That is the new rumor that just popped up on Sunday. I think it's a fascinating rumor. One of you actually had just recently asked me who I thought should play John Stewart, because Idris Elba obviously isn't available because he's tied up with Marvel and as Heimdall in the Thor movies. And I was like, I don't know who it could be. And Denzel Washington is genius. I think he would be a fantastic choice for the role. I think he can anchor, he can lead a movie, he can open a film. Something that the Green Lantern franchise desperately needs. And after the misfire with Ryan Reynolds, I think they really need to change things up to this degree. I know there are Hal Jordan fans out there, but there are a lot of John Stewart fans thanks to the animated series from Bruce Timm. And Paul Dini, I believe, also worked on that, but largely it was Bruce Timm's. But I think that Denzel Washington would be a fantastic choice, and I think really help the Green Lantern franchise and give it a seriousness and a gravitas. And Denzel can have fun, too. I mean, I really like him when he plays in his roles. I think we all know he can still handle action. I thought Two Guns, I enjoyed Two Guns. I thought he was very good in it. Safe House was a big hit for him. Recently with, ironically, Ryan Reynolds. So I think he would be a fantastic choice, and I think one of the better casting decisions DC has ever made. And also it's interesting because there are a couple of viewer questions today. I'm going to actually fold this one into the episode because it's so applicable to this one. But Shagan Prime said, "Hey Grace, I was wondering why doesn't DC change their age range to fit an older demographic to get some of their more darker, frightening scenes and also make their films more story-driven onto the big screen? This is my first question. Hope it gets answered." Smiley face. I love the smiley faces. Thank you, Shagan Prime. I'm answering your question and it's going up first actually right away because I think as you can see, Denzel would be obviously an older person cast in their roles. And I think that would be fantastic. I think that to answer your question, the reason that comic book franchises cast so young is because they want to make sure their actors can stay for a long time with the movies. Although, as I said with Andrew Garfield, if he's leaving after 3, what's the point then? Just cast the best person for the role if these people aren't going to stay on for multiple films beyond that. Although Marvel, for instance, though, I think will be keeping people longer. I don't know what's going on with Andrew Garfield, but I know a lot of you want to see him go anyway, so it's okay. But I do think that DC and Marvel movies need to have more range in terms of the ages that are there. I think it just makes the stories not only more appealing to a wider demographics. You want to get older moviegoers in you already have the younger moviegoers for comic book stuff. Of course, comic book fans, but you want to get that mainstream moviegoer who's maybe potentially, the older baby boomer set. And I think they would be really intrigued to see maybe Denzel Washington in this role. I can't think of better casting. It would be amazing if that happened. This is one of those situations where it's get your checkbook out, Warner Brothers, and pay Denzel what he needs to play this role. It would be phenomenal, and phenomenal for Denzel's career. He does very well. He's a little uneven at the box office, but as I said, he can't open a movie. And this would be, I think, another great surge for him in terms of his movie star appeal. But another thing I wanted to bring up on this note, there's so much stuff going on, but I talked about a Miles Morales movie also. That was one of your questions on Friday. And some sad news, or scary news, came out over the weekend as well. Brian Michael Bendis said that Ultimate Spider-Man is done. He's wrapping it up. And so that leaves the question of what's going to happen to Miles. So I think the whole Ultimate Universe is folding in on itself with Cataclysm. Galactus is there. I think he's going to eat it. The question is, will he burp out Miles Morales? Or will Miles Morales escape to the 616? I think that's what we'd all like to see happen. I think it needs to happen for the Miles Morales movie to maybe take place. Maybe that's the next step on that road. But I think to just throw Miles Morales away would be, that would be really bad. I think that would be up there with what they did to Peter Parker and Mary Jane for some Spider-Man fans. I would be appalled. I mean, taking away Miles Morales and Damian Wayne and Emma Frost isn't written well anymore. I mean, come on. Comic books are like on my last nerve sometimes lately, because I think they're so movie focused. I think comic books, this is actually a discussion I was having with somebody the other day. I just read some comics and they're all kind of only okay. And I was like, such a shame that comics now just seem to be like serving the purpose of backing up the movies instead of focusing on just telling great stories. We'll see what happens. But Miles Morales is, I think, definitely the most popular character right now in comics in terms, you know, of being, you know, not a white guy. So to get rid of him, I just can't believe Marvel would do that. So look for him maybe to be moving to the 616. So this could be great news. That's why I said it's scary. We don't know which way it's going to go. All right, so that's the first very, very complex story of the day. The second story of the day is that Marvel, the Fox investors, 20th Century Fox, got wind of a potential crossover, and it's leaked. And basically, the investors were told that Fox is very seriously considering an X-Men crossover with the Fantastic Four. And apparently, or basically, as Fox runs it, Wolverine versus the Fantastic Four. And what's going to happen is there's going to be something about the origins of the Fantastic Four that cause a fight. And so the X-Men are like, we have to, you know, fight you guys. And it's based on like a miniseries, which, by the way, I don't know. I've never really heard of the miniseries of X-Men versus Fantastic Four. Maybe some of you have, I don't know. But this isn't exactly like a comic book like Days of Future Past, where people hear about it and they're like, oh, finally, it's getting the big screen treatment. I think the bigger reaction would be, really, they crossed over? Do I think this would work? Well, there are different levels I think that have to be taken into account here. First of all, the power sets seem so similar. I mean, I know that they got their powers from different places. You know, the X-Men, it's an evolutionary thing. It's in genetic. It's in their genetic code. And then, of course, the Fantastic Four had a horrible experience with cosmic rays in space. But the end result, we have to all agree, is pretty much the same. So I think a lot of mainstream moviegoers could be like, I can't sort these people out. The other thing is, if they go for the young casting they're considering for Fantastic Four, like Miles Teller, for instance, and Allison Williams from Girls, Reed Richards and Sue Storm, then they're going to be even less discernible from the X-Men. So unless they make a really concentrated effort to make very different franchises, it's just going to seem like we got some new X-Men, especially to non-comic book readers. So I think it could just seem really convoluted. And the reason also, another thing I think that DC and Fox really need to consider is that people didn't love the Avengers just because it was a big smorgasbord of superheroes. The real reason that movie did so well, in my opinion, and I think a lot of you would agree, is because there were a lot of superheroes there done right. The series was built correctly. We were introduced to them in individual films. And I think that that allowed them not to have to touch so much on the characters when they came together, because they'd already been developed in their own movies. And even so, the characters were handled correctly. I think just throwing a bunch of characters together and just like shaking the bag up and being like, awesome, huh? I think isn't really understanding. I mean, it's almost like it's like such a negative view of comic books, I think, from the studios. Like, people just like to see their favorite character on screen. And of course, there is something to that that's fun, but nobody likes to see their favorite character, raked across the coals on the screen. I mean, that's just painful to watch. And I think that it's assuming that comic books are just like pulp and they're all about like, oh, who uses their powers? But at the heart of great comics, and the reason that so many people read them, the reason I read them and people continue to read them, even though they were introduced to them as a child into adulthood, is because of the stories. They're great stories. So unless these people, these comic book movies, start working on better stories, it doesn't matter how many people they throw up there. Just ask everyone who saw X-Men The Last Stand. However, though, to this day, still the most successful X-Men movie at the box office. So it's really hard to to say too many bad things about it to a studio executive, because they're like, but look at the numbers. So, interesting fact there. But I'm curious, how many of you wanted to see an X-Men versus Fantastic Four crossover? Do you feel it's redundant? Do you really feel that they're the same kind of teams, basically? And do you think that Fox is doing a good job? And do you think that everyone is just in a race to copy Disney Marvel, just like they're trying to do this ridiculously overcrowded Man of Steel 2, and now they're trying to do an X-Men, Fantastic Four crossover? It just reeks of imitation. It might be the sincerest form of flattery, but the imitation still is not as good as the original. All right, so that's the second story of the day. The third story of the day is actually another comic book story, a lot of comic book news, really dominates the headlines, is that Gal Gadot, I'm trying to get her name right, so if I got it wrong again, this is a process, it's an ongoing process, so I think it's Gal Gadot. She gave her first interview post having landed the role of Wonder Woman with an Israeli entertainment news show. And basically, she responded to the criticism, and she, people saying that she didn't have the right body type for the role, and she argued that, hey, I am the Wonder Woman for today. Also, if I was going exactly like an Amazon, I'd have only one breast, and I think she's going off the original Amazon legends, and it's not from the comic at all, so I think she tried to, intellectualize the argument and be like, haha, but instead I think she just left a lot of people scratching their heads being like, I don't think you've read a Wonder Woman comic, Gal, if that's what you think. So there's that aspect of it. She did say that she would be building some body mass in her training. But I have to say, though, I don't think she's going to build that much, because if you wanted someone who had a lot of body mass, why would you cast Gal Gadot in the first place? I mean, obviously, you basically, Zack Snyder and his team like the way she looks, basically, and so that's what they want. I mean, it's not like they cast like an Academy Award-winning actress and they were like, we'll bulk her up. I mean, you cast someone who gets roles so far for her appearance. So, I mean, they cast her for that reason. So I don't see her bulking up that much. I think they're going to argue, hey, she is an Amazonian warrior, and so she has superpowers. So she doesn't need to be super muscular. And we'll see how audiences respond to that. I'm not counting out Gal Gadot yet. I liked her in Fast 6, and I hope she does well here. I mean, I'm very suspicious of the casting. As I said, I want her to wear pants. And I think, Gal Gadot, I've seen a lot of her photos online. She seems to be very image conscious about how she looks. And I think that could be potentially a big stumbling block for Wonder Woman. I think the actress who plays Wonder Woman shouldn't be concerned about that, because it's going to give her she's going to be too concerned with that. You don't want someone voguing in the Wonder Woman role. But we have to kind of really try and hope this works out, though, because I think this is going to be a pace leader, and I think a lot of studios are going to be watching the Wonder Woman response from audiences to see if they should make more female superhero movies. So I hope it works out. So that's what she said. But I think the most interesting thing about the whole, also I have to say, I am somewhat concerned this could be another Malin Ackerman Silk Spectra. You guys always say, the thing with comics is these things are written down. They're never said out loud. So it's hard to know how to pronounce them. But anyway, I feel like Malin Ackerman, very nice actress, but I think that she, was not the powerhouse she needed to be for that role in Watchmen, and I worry that this is going to be a similar situation. But the other thing that really fascinated me about the story about Gal Gadot's interview, was that she said that they're going to start filming in Michigan very soon, like almost right after the new year, which is like, so get ready for a lot of set pictures hopefully to leak. I mean, that's what I think we would expect, but when I thought of that, I thought, oh, for the love of God, please, Warner Brothers, have some secrecy on your set. Shoot indoors. It's okay. Look at what they can do with green screen these days. I'm so concerned about major plot points leaking about the film. I think they did a pretty good job hiding things for Man of Steel, but I think that this was a huge problem for The Dark Knight Rises, which gave a lot away. They had problems with set leaks on Captain America, The Winter Soldier, to the point where they're holding up poster board saying, please don't take photos. And people are like, what are you, crazy? Of course I'm going to take photos. It's your fault for being out here. But it looks like they didn't spoil anything too big there, because we've seen some of those shots of the Winter Soldier anyway in the trailer. But I do really hope they keep things under wrap. I don't want to see this stuff too early. I like to know what's going on. I like these early stories, but I think we have to draw a line somewhere. And I think when it ruins the actual movie-going experience, that's the line. So I hope that they do a good job of keeping things under wraps. But if you live in Michigan, find out where they're shooting and see what you can find out. All right, so those are the three stories of the day. The viewer question, I already answered one. This one is from Perseus Halliwell. And Perseus, so this also ties into today's story. So Perseus says, "Hi, Grace. Big fan of the show and love hearing your opinions and reviews. Thank you, Perseus. Question, with the success of The Avengers, do you think Disney will go the route of bigger, almost Michael Bay-style team-up films and forget about the individual hero films we've come to know from Marvel? I was not a fan," says Perseus, "of Iron Man 3, and besides Loki's snide comments, Thor the Dark World was a letdown. Thanks in advance for your thoughts." Thank you for your question, Perseus. And the reason I brought this up is because I think it really plays into what you're seeing here. More team-up films. And while Thor the Dark World did very well at the box office, and Iron Man 3 made $1 billion, still, clearly, they're not Avengers-level successes. Iron Man 3 almost is. But I think that you might be right about Disney moving more towards team-up films, because Robert Downey Jr. is not signed for any more Iron Man films. He said he would come back for an undisclosed sum, but he only wants to do Avengers movies. So he signed on for Avengers 2 and 3. And I think Disney was just happy to have him. So Robert Downey Jr. clearly agrees with you, Perseus, that that is the future of comic book movies, team-up films. That he wants to be front and center at the heart of those films, which is very smart. I think that's, you know, very savvy on his part. I don't want to see individual movies go away. I think that there is some problem that once you open the door to team-ups, you start, I think many of us watch, you know, Iron Man 3 and Thor the Dark World and go, why don't the other superheroes jump in and help them? I think the screenwriters at Marvel and DC need to be very careful about coming up with scenarios where that doesn't need to happen, where you don't, you know, I think they need to keep, you know, for instance, Thor the Dark World maybe should have stayed in the Nine Realms and stayed away from Midgard, because then it wouldn't be necessary to bring in the Avengers. But once you have like a cataclysmic event which threatens Earth, how could the other superheroes not get involved? Also at the end of Iron Man 3, a lot of us felt, well, hey, and that's, by the way, why Iron Man 3 didn't make my top 10 list of the year, because while I really had a fun time watching the movie and I thought it was very clever, I thought the Mandarin role that Guy Pearce played should have been played by an Asian actor. And I also felt the ending, the big action sequence at the end on that rig or ship was only, you know, I guess it was actually a freighter ship. I felt that it was, you know, a little lacking. I thought it wasn't very energized. It was felt small as well. And part of that was the President of the United States has been kidnapped and none of the other Avengers come to help. It just seems odd. You know, you don't see S.H.I.E.L.D. in there trying to help. It just becomes a weird scenario. And it's like, it's just distracting, especially if you're really getting into these cinematic universes. So I think that if they're going to continue with the solo films, that needs to be the way. However, what I would really love to see happen, actually, is I'd love to see them continue to make solo films, but for new characters. I'm very excited to see what they do with Ant-Man. I would love to see a Black Widow film, though. I will say that I would like to see that. I think a lot of us like to see a Doctor Strange film, a Black Panther film. I think these are all things that we would love to see happen, and maybe that's what they could use the solo films for, Guardians of the Galaxy, to introduce these characters, really get us to know them, and then graduate them to the big leagues. So I'm curious what you guys think. Do you want to see a Thor 3? Do you want to see Captain America 3? Are you excited about Captain America 2? Do you want to see Iron Man 4? Or do you want to see these new characters come into play instead? Do you think maybe that, you know, once you really get to know a character like Iron Man or Thor, you don't need to continue to have these solo adventures. They can just go to the Avengers. So write your thoughts down below. Thank you for tuning in. Let me know what stories you'd like. There will be no morning movie news on Tuesday or Wednesday because of the holiday, but it will be back on Thursday. So let me know what you'd like to see covered there and any questions you might have. Thanks for watching. Bye.